The year is 1991. Pop culture is now completely submerged in 90s world building. We're in the years that are eventually going to bring the decade to a steamy boil, you know, with Pogs and Beanie Babies and this sound and this cup. I could probably do an entire video on this jazzy chalice. Maybe you were busy playing with your Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Technodrome, or your Swamp Thing Swamp Trap, or your Ghostbusters Proton Pack that your mom never got you and you're still waiting on after 30 years. It's not too late, Mom. The entertainment options of 1991 were, they were good. Great movies, video games, the Super NES had just released to compete with the Sega Genesis, which wasn't even a competition because the SNES was absolutely the superior console. Don't at me. This was decided 30 years ago. I don't want to hear it. Like, I realize I need to get to my main topic here. I'm setting the ambiance, okay? I'm almost there. I promise. But there were some solid family movies in 1991, and there were some other great films, too, that you may have been lucky to see as a kid, but probably weren't allowed to. But when I look back on 1991, nothing has a grip on my 90s kid brain more than Hook. No, not that Hook. That's still 3 years away, but it's still an absolute bangerang. Ooh. I'm talking about the sequel to Peter Pan. I'm talking about Steven Spielberg, Robin Williams, Dustin Hoffman, a handheld Julia Roberts, John Williams providing the vibes, and, you know, other memorable performances from A-list actors and celebrities like Gwyneth Paltrow, Glenn Close, Phil Collins, George Lucas, and Carrie Fisher. That's right, you didn't even know they were in it at the time if you were a kid, but they were there. In terms of movie critics, Hook's reception was, it was lukewarm at best. I wasn't even aware what critics were saying when I was a kid. It was the 90s. I wasn't picking up a newspaper to see what Rotten Tomatoes says. No, I had to form my own take, and my take was this. Hook had sword fighting, flying sequences, food fights, the Lost Boys, skateboarding, and this duel? And listen, if you were a kid in the 90s, you probably didn't realize it at the time, but Hook was establishing a lot for our film, entertainment, and pop culture awareness of the time. And for that reason, I want to take a look back at what I consider to be a pillar of 90s kid adventure movies. So take a seat, grab a drink, and let's reminisce about the movie Hook. The appeal or hook of Hook, It's Peter Pan in live action, a character who flies around the sandbox that is Neverland, all while never growing up. Of course, it is a little different this time. I mean, in Hook, Peter Pan is grown up, which, looking back at that fact, is probably not the best story pitch for a movie to appeal to kids. Like, what kid wants a grown-up Peter Pan? We want the Peter Pan that we can relate to, one that's relatively our age, that we can live vicariously through as he goes on adventures in this sort of fantasy land. Not some old guy. I mean, and that may have been a deal breaker for some kids, but not for me. And here's why. He's Peter Pan, but he's your dad. And I know that sounds lame. That's kind of the point, right? What if your dad, and his dad belly, and his dad suspenders, and his dad's cell phone, which I'm pretty sure my dad would still use today if sales associates like Alex would just let him live his life and leave him alone. What if he all of a sudden remembered what it was like to not be a dad? What if he learned to use a sword? What if he could fly? What if he didn't need to wear glasses anymore? Ugh. What if Julia Roberts had a low-key crush on him? What if he gained the respect of kids everywhere, including this badass right here? Are you seeing this guy? Like, the whole premise of Hook sort of blossomed from screenwriter James Hart's kid, who was 6 at the time, asking him the question, what if Peter Pan grew up? It was probably followed up by some other question like, why don't babies have clothes on when they're born? Or whatever dumb question kids ask. And look, maybe you don't see this film from Peter Banning's perspective. Maybe you see it from Jack's or Maggie's. Like, maybe you just spontaneously sing songs to deal with an absent father. I'm gonna be honest here, Jack annoyed the shit out of me, even when I was a kid. Like, I'm looking at him like, dude, your dad is Peter Pan. Like, you'll see. Just be patient. Like, stop throwing the damn baseball on the plane. What the hell is wrong with you? At this point, you're probably thinking, someone needs to kidnap this Jack kid. Well, I don't want to bore you with every plot point of this movie. You've probably seen it enough times to where you're watching a random dude on YouTube talking about the movie. But since we're reminiscing together, I do want to go over some of the major beats of this film and mention a few moments that really still stand out to me, even to this day. Back to Jack, had this kid cause explosive decompression on this plane, that may have been a less terrifying experience than being kidnapped by a Captain James Hook. Just saying. That scene, man. I mean, like that latch just turning, that hook-shaped latch that's turning, and John Williams' score is just straight fire, of course. Toodles is just burning the word hook into your brain with his dead eyes and his jiggling jowls. Looking back at this moment as an adult now, no one really had any sense of urgency about these missing kids. Like, even Inspector Phil Collins was like, so take a look at me now. No, he suggested it may be a prank. Do you remember what that house looked like?
One does.
It looked like a massacre took place there. And while I'm sure Wendy is used to Toodles absolutely wrecking that house, because clearly that guy knows how to throw a party, no, this was the work of a space pirate. Anyway, so Peter returns to Neverland at this point, and we're 35 minutes into this film. How did we have the patience as kids? I will say that we did know a little bit about endurance. Imagine trying to play Fortnite, except you have to blow into a cartridge 8 times and slam it right on the edge of your gaming console just right, and then it would actually... Never mind. What I loved about The Lost Boys as a kid, and still appreciate to this day, is the fact that you've got these kids living their best life without parental guidance at all. It's sort of a Lord of the Flies situation. And the film just does a very good job of dropping you right into the middle of their world. They have their own phrases and their own chants, and they sort of operate in unison with one another. It's all very rhythmic. And of course it's all choreographed and written this way, but my point is it just felt like a club. I wanted to be a part of this club. I still want to be a part of this club, I think. And Peter is almost excluded from it until a young David Alan Grier sees Peter for what he really is. Peter Pan.
Oh, there you are, Peter. Peter? Yeah.
So let's go, let's pick him up. Of course there are other moments during the Pan montage that are happening. Like, you get a nice little suicide attempt from Hook, which he backs out of. So Peter whips into shape and has a bit of a breakthrough while he's in the middle of a heated roast session with a 14-year-old, or however old Rufio is. I don't know, he like still looks 30 to me, even after seeing this movie after all these years, because of how much I watched it as a kid. Peter wills a feast from his imagination, which, oh, it still looks incredible to this day. That feast. I still think about that feast. I mean, I could probably do an entire video dedicated to that spread. It looks so good. And you slice that coconut and you are Pan. Sure, he has to remember his whole life story, like when he was a young Jonas brother watching Gwyneth Paltrow, who turns into Maggie Smith. And then there's more sexual tension between Peter and Tinkerbell, which is honestly a little confusing as a kid because Julia Roberts is good looking, obviously. She's maybe 3 inches tall. But okay, we have Peter Pan. He's flying through the trees. He's flying above the clouds. He's flying above Neverland, which looks like a stock image that Steven Spielberg just uploaded into the film. But okay, all right. Rufio hands Peter the sword. John Williams' score is swelling. It makes the moment believable, cathartic. After an hour and 40 minutes, Peter Pan is here. He's here. But before he can save his kids, Tinkerbell can't contain her thirst any longer and grows into a full human size in order to fulfill her lifelong dream of convincing someone into an extramarital affair. Let's be honest, Dustin Hoffman and Bob Hoskins had more believable sexual tension than these two. It's all very awkward, one of the most just out of place moments in the entire film, in my opinion. But let's get into the final battle, which there's a lot. It's a lot. You've got adults fighting adults. You've got kids fighting adults. Toss in a little bit of Stockholm Syndrome. And whatever this move was, I still don't even know. What was that? But let's open the wound and share the trauma together. You know what I'm talking about. You can almost hear Hook's sort of ominous goading.
Rufio, Rufio.
If you've heard the phrase, looky, looky, I've got hooky, and not taken pause to just bury that PTSD you're experiencing, then I don't even... I don't even know if this video is for you, and that's okay. This was a big fun brawl at first. We had kids shooting reflective daylight into pirates' eyes. They were shooting eggs and marbles and then just hook straight stabs a kid. We're just all kids having a good time. Like if you were a kid in the 90s, you're just on the playground being silly. You got a paper fortune teller or cootie catcher, whatever you want to call it. One, two, three, four. Number two, okay, you smell. And then that one kid takes it too personally and stabs Rufio in the heart. Hook gets what he deserves in the end though, when the stuffed corpse of the crocodile just sort of lands on him, I guess. I don't know. I still don't know what that was. Lightly inhaling Hook? I don't know. Peter gathers his two children together who now respect him because he went on a vision quest for 3 days and learned how to fly. And he leaves the Lost Boys in the capable hands of Thud Butt. That's right, that was his name, Thud Butt, not Bowling Ball Kid. You may not have even known that. It's not like they ever said his name in the movie. So there you go. Anyway, so Peter's ready to be a good dad. So it's this happy moment where he reconnects with his children and abandons these other children with no guardian to care for them. But hey, that's fine. We're in Neverland. It's a magical place where they can all just have fun. I mean, what could go wrong? Anyway, so everyone's happy. Peter's back at Wendy's house. We aren't sure what exactly happened. I mean, do the kids remember anything? Why is Smee a groundskeeper? What was this? I still don't know. Do you know? I don't know what this was. Was this all just a dream? Probably not, because Toodles is now flying and the credits are rolling. Doesn't matter. Dopamine rush. John Williams score going on. It really is a good movie. Final thoughts. Was Hook a flawless film? Absolutely not. Was it unfairly judged as a product of its time? Yeah, I think so. Regardless of your age or your generation, whether you're a 90s kid like me or a beautiful, beautiful boomer. With this film, you have great performances, a director in the midst of his prime, regardless of the clunky writing and pacing at times within this film. You have what I believe to be one of John Williams' best scores, and you have a cell phone duel. Let's not forget that. But seriously, regardless of the regrets that Spielberg has stated he has about this film, and regardless of the fact that Robin Williams, who is arguably in his prime as well, probably should have embraced some of the fun, childish performances that he had on display much sooner than the third act of this film, especially considering its bloated runtime, there's a reason people still bring up Hook and consider it a classic from their childhood. There's sort of a power in generational or nostalgic groupthink. 90s kids like me are adults now, and films and television shows that were considered box office bombs or ratings disasters by the generation that defined commercial and critical success at the time are now being revisited, supported, celebrated. It's why Hocus Pocus is getting a sequel and Treasure Planet is now considered an animated classic. It's why Powerline is considered an iconic pop star. He is. And of course, many 90s kids are grown and have kids of their own now. So between our encouragement of future generations to check out these films, along with this sort of fetishization of 90s culture that's going on right now, it's a recipe for, like it or not, reboots, remakes, and sequels that are happening decades after the original films. Much like the premise of the film Hook, we are now getting the answer to the question of, what if 90s kids grew up? And all of this is to say that Hook deserves to be a part of the conversation of nostalgia and appreciation for a decade that contains a lot of underappreciated films. It certainly deserves its share of criticism, but it is interesting to me that people are now just discovering this film and enjoying it almost as much as I did, you know, nearly 30 years ago. So pop in this movie, or tap it, or click it, or however you watch movies these days, and revisit this film. And if you're like me and you know every beat of this movie by heart, I just hope that you appreciate revisiting what I consider to be a 90s classic. If you like this review, you like this take on sort of 90s film, leave a comment. Let me know what you think and give suggestions. Maybe another film that you'd like me to cover that maybe we share a similar interest in. Nothing else, thanks for watching.